tonight, Dan, and directing his team all night long.
All right, Aaron, thank you. We are ready with Tony Padilla, Martin Cota, and Tom Wood. The officials here tonight, and the Bears get the first possession of the game. A great battle of quickness at the point guard spot with Collison and Randall.
UCLA starting off in man-to-man, and they're going to have to get right on shooters off of those screens.
Christopher, 29 points Thursday night in an overtime win over USC. Up there by Dragovich. Randall lost the handle for just a second, now recovers. He's listed at 5'10". He's not close to that. He's playing a bigger guard in Collison, and UCLA's got a lot of big bodies to come help. Wilkes has it swatted away. Here come the Bruins. Aboya will miss the running layup.
And a nice job by Robertson to get back and contest that.
This time, Wilkes will finish. The son of former UCLA and Lakers star Jamal Wilkes, athletically a junior, academically a senior, and he's decided to give up his year of eligibility next year and to move on, as Reese said earlier, to the next chapter of his life. Meanwhile, Josh Shipp, the younger brother of former Cal star Joe Shipp, knocking down the outside shot.
That's a big, big plus for UCLA, I think, Dan, with Shipp hitting his first shot from the outside.
Jay, you were at Stanford Thursday night, and Shipp had a great game there.
Well, there hasn't been a hotter player in Pac-10 play, shooting 55% from three in the Pac-10.
Christopher loses it, and then a foul is called on Alfred Aboya, who is wide-eyed in disbelief at the call. And Ben Howland feels the same way. What can you say about the job Ben Howland has done at UCLA? Three consecutive Final Fours, twice to the national championship game, or once, excuse me, to the national championship game, and also three consecutive Pac-10 regular season titles. Christopher.
That was very well executed. Just a little screen for the screener play. They didn't switch, and they were too slow getting off the screen on the other side.
In UCLA, we have the number one team in the nation in field goal percentage. In Cal, the number one team in the nation in three-point percentage. Collison gets a good screen from Aboya. Dragovich.
UCLA is a lot more stagnant, Jay, on offense than Cal has been thus far.
Randall, and he'll draw the foul. It'll be on Collison, I believe.
You can see Patrick Christopher setting a screen and then coming off the screen set by Wilkes, and both defenders went with him, just shot right over the top. He's a catch-and-shoot player. You've got to make him put the ball on the deck.
There's Randall at the line. Mike Montgomery inherited a fairly experienced group. All five starters for Cal are juniors. Spencer Wilkes is a redshirt junior, longtime coach at Stanford, a couple of years with Golden State prior to Stanford, Montana, been to the Final Four once with Stanford. What are your thoughts, Coach, on Mike Montgomery and the job he's done with this group?
Well, I think he was really looking to have a chance to come back into college basketball. He was not real suited to the pro game, nor it to him. And I think a lot of coaches are like that. He got out of it. He looked for a good opportunity and got it here at Cal.
Cal was just 6-12 in the Pac-10 last year and lost a couple of players who were drafted into the NBA, including a first-round pick in Ryan Anderson.
Well, UCLA not taking very good care of the ball, and Cal very active on the defensive end, active with their feet, also active with their hands.
And Jerome Randall active on the offensive end. This time it is Dragovich who commits the foul.
I think right now you used the word active, Jay. I think that Cal is more active at both ends of the floor than UCLA is.
UCLA has lost three of its last five. They're not playing as well as a team as they were a month ago when they were blowing people out, including Cal. They blew out Notre Dame, blew out Stanford, blew out USC. Hometown bounce for Patrick Christopher.
I always refer to that shot that goes off the board like that is an 8-inch miss that's worth 3 points.
Collison splits the double team. Extra pass to Drew Holiday. And the freshman, it drops in the floater from the baseline.
Now that young man is going to be a very, very good player. He's not there yet. Huge hands, can put the ball on the floor. No holes in his game, a versatile player.
You know, the control he has with moving the ball, the movement is awfully good.
Christopher picking up tonight right where he left off Thursday night against USC.
Now, Dan, there you see with Patrick Christopher his catch and shoot ability. Josh Shipp switched out on him, but still it wasn't enough. He's seen a couple go in. He's got his rhythm. He feels comfortable as a shooter. Now they've got to make him into a dribbler.
Holiday has been on him some as well, and Ben Howland's going to go to his bench at the next opportunity, perhaps to try to get somebody to slow down Christopher.
Christopher coming off a baseline screen. Well, this was the last shot, just a little pull-up jumper, and he had to pull up off the dribble there, and that one went off the glass, a little bit of a lucky shot. That last one on the baseline, he had a catch-and-shoot opportunity. That's where he's at his best.
And Malcolm Lee, number one, is coming to the game now for UCLA to replace Holiday. As Shipp misses the layup, saved by Christopher. Malcolm Lee is a guy Ben Howland told us yesterday is starting to get more and more minutes. Good athlete, terrific defender. Vanessa Boya comes down with a rebound. Collison, and this time Shipp makes sure that he doesn't miss.
That's a good point, Dan, because Shipp was careless on the last move down the floor when he missed the layup.
Christopher right now outscoring UCLA all by himself. It's Lee on Christopher now as Shipp knocks it away. Ball's still loose. And the Bruins will get two more.
What a nice play by Aboya, getting on the floor for that ball and having the presence of mind to get it to Shipp for an easy basket. That was well done.
Arthur DeBoy, a senior from Cameroon, has played through injuries, plays with heart, leadership, intangibles, everything that Ben Howland could ever ask of. UCLA back within two. Cal turns it over to take us to our first media timeout of the night. Patrick Christopher of the Bears is the early story, coming off a 29-point game Thursday night against USC. He's got eight in the early going tonight, and Cal's got a slim lead. Back here in beautiful Berkeley, Dan Shulman, Bob Knight, Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews. The Cal Golden Bears, 10-5 in the Pac-10 this year. They were picked eighth preseason. They are tied for second right now with UCLA. They have swept Washington, the first place team in the Pac-10. They went on the road at UNLV. They beat Arizona State. Jay, at this point, are they a lock?
I think they are. Yeah, I think that California has done enough to get in. Not only their strength of schedule is good, they've won 10 conference games. I think their win at UNLV is going to be a big boost on their resume to get them in the tournament.
Cal, by the way, will finish off the regular season at the Arizona schools before they head to the Staples Center for the Pac-10 tournament. UCLA will finish at home against the Oregon schools. Collison from the wing.
Now, Darren Collison is as efficient a point guard as you are going to find. He can shoot it from the perimeter, and with Randall guarding him, Randall's going to have to get out to him quicker because Collison could just see and shoot over the top of him.
And UCLA on top now by a point after Cal roared out to the early lead on the strength of Christopher. Christopher will pull up again. Jamal Boykin reverses and lays it in.
Really good head fake inside. And then when you take the ball to the opposite side, Dan, the bucket acts as a protector for your shot, as you well know.
And Jamal Boykin content to let the three perimeter guys do the scoring, just there to help him out on the inside. Lee is fouled.
You know, Boykin gets so much off playing with these three guards. One, the floor is spread, but when a shot goes up, two defenders go to block it. That leaves an opening on the offensive glass. Nobody blocks out. He averages over two offensive rebounds per game and leads this team in rebounding at over 6.5 per game. And he's just a really hard worker. You've got to lay a body on every possession.
There's Malcolm Lee at the line now for UCLA. We mentioned that Ben Howland had some very nice things to say about him yesterday. A couple of weeks or last week against Washington State, Ben Howland did not play Drew Holiday for a single minute in the second half. Was upset with Holiday's defense. Put Lee in there. Thought Lee defended much better. And Lee is in the game right now to try and slow down Patrick Christopher.
You know, Jay, an interesting part of this game is the offense that the guards supply for both teams, not just from a scoring standpoint, but their ability to penetrate as well. And as you mentioned a moment ago, create different things for different people on the floor.
Well, UCLA is trying to hedge off a lot of these screens and staggers. And I think that Cal can get some slips and some things going to the basket for the screener if Randall is able to see open.
This is Harper Camp, who has just checked in for Cal, number 43. And the reverse for Christopher, who is unstoppable right now.
You know, Christopher made a great cut there, Dan. As soon as the feed went into the post, Christopher set up his man and got to the bucket. It was a really, really good cut.
Coach, is moving without the ball one of the underappreciated aspects of the game?
Well, yeah, and I think it's one of the great things that leads to good offense.
Collison with the pull-up. Soft touch, and it drops.
Dragovich came out to set a ball screen, and no one refuses ball screens more than Collison. You've really got to force him into that screen instead of giving up that baseline.
Have you seen a better guard on the move with his shot than Collison is?
Good? No, not at all, because he's so fast. I mean, I think Randall's quicker, but Collison's faster.
And we got a 3 seconds all. Just too much interior passing by the Bears. Big Monday presented by Bud Light is on ESPN at 7 Eastern. Jay will be there at Notre Dame as Villanova takes on the Irish. And then at 9 Eastern, it is Baylor at number 24. Texas Big Monday presented by Bud Light. Jay, today Georgetown won at Villanova. So, you know, the Wildcats will not be in a good mood when they get to South Bend. And Notre Dame gave number 2 Connecticut all they could handle, but ultimately came up short.
Yeah, I think it's a game that Notre Dame has to have. I think Notre Dame has to get to 9-9 in the league and win a game or two in the Big East tournament to feel comfortable that they've got a reasonable shot to get in as an at-large game.
Dragovich leaves it short. He has been shooting very well since he became a starter, about coinciding with the beginning of Pac-10 plays. A little bit under the weather, but has started, but has not found the rhythm with his stroke so far.
What you mentioned a moment ago, Jay, though, about somebody taking advantage of two guys picking up the ball, but Dragovich shot it so quickly, I don't think he was set to shoot it.
Collison, Drew Holiday is back in there, misses the three, and this is Jorge Gutierrez, number 2, who comes down with a rebound for Cal. He feeds Randall, and Randall buries it. Coming up, we continue our countdown of the top 30 plays of the last 30 years. Now here in Berkeley, this team shoots the three better than any team in America. 44% as a team on the season, and they are 3-for-5 already tonight. And coach, from Jerome Randall, we just saw about a 25-footer. That young man's got some serious range.
Well, you could see him get set up to shoot the ball, Dan, before he ever took the shot. He was going to take the shot. You know, Jay, this is one of the few times in many years that I think Cal probably matches UCLA in athletic ability.
No question. And they match him certainly with guard play. But that shot by Randall is one of their secondary break options. That's called their point push, where he pushes the ball down court in order to shoot it.
Christopher the steal. Christopher all the way. And Gordon called for the foul. And now Boykin, as Christopher's whooping a little bit at Gordon, Boykin gets in there. It's emotional early here at Cal.
Darren Collison tried to throw that ball back in after he got double teamed, and Gordon blocking the shot but catching Christopher down low. And Patrick Christopher, a really good competitor, and Jamal Boykin doing that's a nice piece of leadership by Boykin to step in there so that nothing can go further between those two players.
And the official stepping in early as well. It is early in this one, but it is intense here at Haas Pavilion. UCLA winning by 15 earlier this year over the Bears. But a Cal team, coach, that you seem to feel week by week is gaining in confidence. And they're starting to look around. Here we are on the verge of March, and they're tied for second in the Pac-10.
Well, I'm sure the new coaching staff, did some things different that took a little while for the kids to understand and get used to. And obviously they liked what was done that was a little bit different, a little bit newer than they've done in the past. And they've done a very good job with it.
And Braun, the coach, the last dozen years here at Cal, now at Rice.
You know, we haven't even mentioned Camp's name, but he has done a really good job so far in 4 or 5 little plays. He's blocked out. He's made 2 good passes. He caused a turnover. He's added a lot to what Cal's doing.
There he is in the post. Nice bounce pass, and Gutierrez can't handle it as it goes out of bounds to the back over to UCLA. Harper Camp of the Bears up 5 on the Bruins here in the early going.
Presents the top 30 plays of the last 30 years. Number 11, Bruce Morris from long range.
The shot later measured at 89 feet.
10 inches. Tune into ESPN on Monday at 7 during the Villanova-Notre Dame game to see play number 10. We will reveal the number one play of the last 30 years on March 15th during the ACC Championship.
Dan, there's been an interesting stat. I'm not all that big on stats, but this early in the game, there have been a combination from both teams of 11 assists and just 6 turnovers. So it's 2-1 in a very hard-played game to this point.
It's got to warm your heart to see both teams moving the ball as well as they have. And here's Camp trying to reach around, and he commits the foul. If you look at Camp, you can see the brace on his right knee and the wrap on his left calf. He had off-season knee surgery. It's still not right, and he says it's the kind of thing that could deteriorate on him at any time. And then he strained his calf last week, missed some time in one game. He barely practiced yesterday there. He's hardly practicing right now, but they need him up front off the bench. He's, as you said, a very smart player, Coach, and they have very little depth up front.
Well, he does see the game as it's unfolding at both ends of the floor.
Amandi Amoki, number 21, into the game for Cal for the first time as well. Holiday with a nice little pass fake, and then he drops in a 15-footer.
You know, that movement of the ball left the defensive man staying away from him, and he had a wide-open look.
So far, Cal shooting 7 of 11 from the field, but the same thing happened with Stanford on Thursday night.
The NBA is on ABC tomorrow as the Detroit Pistons head to Boston to take on the Celtics. Then it's the Lakers and Suns, Kobe and Shaq at 3:30 Eastern. And then an evening game on ESPN, LeBron of the Cavs taking on Atlanta at 8 o'clock. Coverage begins at 12:30 Eastern with the GMC NBA countdown. Let's see Stephon Marbury in his second game in a Boston Celtic uniform. Michael Roll knocks it away. Comes up with a loose ball. Into the chest of Gutierrez, missed it, and Camp rips down the rebound in traffic.
You know, Camp loses the ball at one end and gets it off the board at the other. It was a real great hustle play.
And then Cal loses it again. Holiday misses. Christopher with a rebound. Up and down they go.
And Camp was the guy that got pressure on the shooter. Boy, that kid does a lot of things in a basketball game that nobody's going to notice.
Christopher left hand. A wave off the basket. Christopher called for the foul after he released the ball, called for the charge.
He was called for the charge there, but Christopher getting to the basket way too easily. I know that Ben Howland is going to want his players to step up. I mean, look how far this 3 dribbles to get into the lane. And a solid job by Aboya to step in there and get that charge from the weak side. That's awfully easy to get into the middle of the lane for Patrick Christopher.
And of concern to Mike Montgomery, the second foul on Patrick Christopher. He sits down, Randall back in.
UCLA on Thursday night against Stanford, even when they got down, showed really good patience, especially Shipp.
Collison the miss. Gutierrez the rebound. He was a late signee.
Boy, Camp forced the miss down there by coming out to help on him.
He's growing on you, huh?
Yeah, he is. I love watching the kid play. He does so many different things.
Another Cal turnover, and as Jay mentioned off the top of the show, that was the big problem for the Bears in their loss to the Bruins earlier this year. Harper Camp, just your ultimate blue collar, do the dirty work, whatever is asked of him kind of guy.
But you know, combined with his willingness to play hard and his strength, the guy has great vision, great understanding of what's going on out there.
Well, when they put Camp in and put Gutierrez in, that's their toughest lineup because both those guys will lay their bodies on the line.
Little push off there by Shipp to free himself. Missed the jumper, Aboya the rebound. And a foul is called. I think it's Camp. It is Harper Camp called for the foul with more on Camp. Here's Aaron Andrews.
Well, and just talking to the Cal coaching staff today about Harper and what he's been able to do. First of all, Dan, you mentioned everything he's been through with his injuries. They mentioned how he feels like he's 60 years old running up and down the court. Mike Montgomery said, you know, his biggest contributions, as coach has been noticing over there, on the defensive end. And obviously when his teammates see him running up and down like he has, and they know his legs don't feel well, that gives the team such a boost.
Aboya with the follow there, Aaron, and that last foul just before we went to Aaron was the second on Camp, and Jordan Wilkes has gone back to the scorer's table.
And Cal went to a little matchup zone as they have a couple times on out-of-bounds underneath, and no blockout responsibilities, and Aboya is so good at chasing after that ball with both hands.
Amoki, a terrific athlete with a strong drive. Now the officials are going to talk it over, reverse the call, and keep the ball with the Bears.
Thank you.
Great play. Boy, he had it, just threw it off the UCLA defender. Pass inside, and Amoki with the layup.
You know, Randall does, we think of him as a shooter, but right there was an example of how hard he looks to find people, too. He dribbled in a little bit of trouble, and with quick footwork, he found somebody open and was able to make the pass for a bucket.
Well, he worked on that pass with his pivot, and you know, he's so quick, and he's leading the Pac-10 in assists, doesn't turn it over very much either.
Right.
And you know, he didn't even come close to walking with the ball.
Ball still loose. Gutierrez has it, tried to pass it off, and it'll be Bears ball off Malcolm Lee.
Again, there's the toughness of Jorge Gutierrez we talked about. And he will lay his body on the line and lay out on the floor to get the ball and get possession of it. And he had a great game earlier this year against Stanford. 10 points, 8 rebounds, and 5 steals. Stanford had been up 22 points in that game, and through Gutierrez, Cal really came back and was able to steal that game.
Gutierrez originally from Mexico, played a couple of years of high school ball in Denver, then 1 year of prep school in Nevada. And Cal took him without seeing him in person. They saw him on film, liked what they saw. Amoki with the reverse. Two big plays for Amoki.
You know, another great example of a kid on the baseline using the basket to protect his shot. Instead of going up in front of the defensive man, he went by the basket and put it between him and the defense.
And the Bears getting great work from their bench. Gutierrez, Camp, and Amoki. Gutierrez just drew a foul. It'll be Cal ball when we come back. Great atmosphere and intensity here at Haas Pavilion, and the Bears are up 5 on the Bruins in the battle for second in the Pac-10. All right, that's a troublesome thing this early for New York Mets fans. We got the UPS halftime report coming up. Reese Davis, Hubert Davis, and presumably Digger Phelps will rejoin them for the UPS halftime report. They'll look at the UConn-Notre Dame game. Blake Griffin returned for Oklahoma today, and did anybody's bubble burst? Jay, is there one team that, in your opinion, particularly helped its cause or hurt its cause today?
I thought Kentucky really hurt their cause with that loss to LSU at home. They've lost 5 home games thus far this year, and I think they're increasingly in a dangerous spot right now on that bubble.
Michael Rohr, one of the best shooters around, and misses the corner three. Follows it up, though, missed again. And Wilkes with a rebound for Cal. Wilkes with a mask on. He suffered a broken nose and a concussion a couple of weeks ago, and then injured his shoulder on Thursday night. So he is beaten up. He's got knee braces on. He's had ankle problems.
Yeah, Cal's defense has been awfully good in this game. They just turned the ball over too much. They turned it over 8 times, but they can afford to leave Patrick Christopher on the bench with those 2 fouls if they continue to defend in this manner.
James Keith into the game, number 13 for UCLA. Shot clock at 5. Randall driving on Collison. Tried to dump it off. Collison the steal. Numbers for the Bruins. And a block on Gutierrez.
And that was really a good call, because Collison made a great move to his left, and Gutierrez moved just enough to make physical contact.
And Collison still down.
Well, he's taking a little breather, Dan. Yeah. He's all right.
Just attack that outside hip. You know, Jerome Randall on the other end just over-penetrated a bit. And to me, anytime you take it too far and you're throwing it back, that's the first pass in your opponent's fast break.
You know, he had the ball in the dribble too much. And he went in once, came back out, and then tried to go again. I think that you can use the dribble to get people open, but there isn't anything more important than passing the basketball to make the defense change position.
And Randall's being given credit under Mike Montgomery for becoming a much better decision maker this year and minimizing his mistakes. When you ask Randall why he's having a better year, he talks about Montgomery. When you ask Montgomery, he says Randall deserves all the credit himself.
Well, that coaching staff has done a very good job with the players that they have. Good cut right there.
Gutierrez leaves it short. Aboya runs down the rebound. Collison got it up on the rim. Aboya had it, lost it out of bounds.
UCLA has had some opportunities. They've just got to be a little bit stronger with the ball.
Jay just mentioned a moment ago that Randall had over-penetrated, and Collison did there too. Collison had such a good shooter on the run, but he had a little 10 or 12-foot shot right in the middle of the lane that he hits very, very hits a very, very good percentage on. He just took the ball too far.
It's not always a hard and fast rule for me, but I've always said, thought if you treat that free throw line like a stop sign, you're going to be in pretty good shape.
Robertson posting up.
Well, plus the fact if you stop at the foul line and somebody comes out to get you, that's when you hit it down inside for a layup.
Now let's keep an eye on Patrick Christopher as Wilkes commits the foul. Christopher has come back in. Remember, he's got two fouls already.
It's hard to stay on your feet when there's a good shot fake made, whether it's inside or outside.
Theo Robertson just breaking off that screen.
That's the old tight cut.
Yep. He just, you know, he is a big, strong shooter. And he can knock down shots from deep, but he can also get to the basket. Pretty good little pull-up game. But that strength is a big factor against smaller guards.
That cut, Dan, the tight cut coming off a stack, is reminiscent of Pete Newell's offense when he coached here at Cal so many years ago and was one of the all-time great coaches ever to coach the game.
As you can see, we are looking at Pete Newell Court. Coach Newell, a Hall of Famer, and you presented him at his Hall of Fame induction, and yourself and Coach Newell, along with Dean Smith, the only three coaches ever to win an NCAA championship, an NIT championship, and an Olympic gold medal. And I know above and beyond the respect that you have for him as a coach, he was also one of the great friends you had.
He's one of the two or three most influential factors in my life, Dan. You know, I loved him like he was a father.
So if it's two or three today, which one of us is on the bubble, you think, in that group? We'll let you sort that out yourself.
Hey, you guys are both really, really good guys, but I preferred Pete Newell's help in coaching than I would from you two guys.
Plus, Pete could pick a restaurant better than we could. Tell you what, Josh Shipp right now is guarding Patrick Christopher, and he is face guarding him. He's not even trying to help off or seeing the ball.
Jeremy Anderson, number five, freshman guard. It's a very young second unit that Ben Howland has on this UCLA team. We've got one freshman who starts, Holiday, with the ball right now, and three who come in off the bench. Holiday in trouble. Gets out of it. Anderson off to Apoya for the slam.
Holiday made a mistake just not backing off of the double team over there. You just can't try and dribble the ball through two guys that have set up a trap for you on a ball screen.
At this point of the season, Coach, would you treat a freshman like a freshman, or should they be playing like a sophomore?
Well, I think they should be playing like a sophomore, but I like them better when they are sophomores.
Christopher hot early before the foul trouble. Randall wide open.
Again, Dan, he had his mind made up that if he was open, he was going to take that shot, because as you watch his feet, he stepped right into the bucket with his left foot and followed it up with a right foot going to the bucket and using that to go off of, up into the ball with his head in front of his feet.
And again, Cal, the number one three-point shooting team in the country at 44%, and they're 4 of 7 tonight. Chip driving on Robertson. Nice feed inside for Aboya.
Well, Aboya does a nice job of making himself available. Oh, he doesn't just stand there. You know, he comes to the ball. He finds an open area. He goes down. He drifts down to the baseline. And that's so important on a baseline drive. There's a big guy makes himself available as a receiver.
Well, that was a great combination with the Bruins down there. The guy with the ball seeing what was there, and the guy with the chance to make the cut also realizing the opportunity. You're so right in how you described that.
What a scoop by Christopher. Back rim, though, and here come the Bruins. Chip sets his feet off the side of the backboard.
Chip didn't get ready there, Dan. That was an ill-advised shot because Chip was moving, and he really didn't get ready.
Randall everything but the finish as he split the defense, and back come the Bruins again. This is a big game, a lot on the line. These two teams tied for second in the Pac-10 at 10-5. Washington won earlier today, beat Arizona State. The Huskies are 13-4. Dragovich is held and finishes.
But that's intentional. He grabbed him. That's got to be intentional.
Well, I don't think so. I think they'll let that go as a foul in the act of shooting. But you're absolutely right. He did grab him to try and keep him from getting a shot. But what an example of strength he had taking that up to the bucket and making it. You'll see it right there.
UCLA back within three. And back here at Haas Pavilion, Dan Shulman, Bob Knight, Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV, all a part of Judgment Week here on the ESPN family of networks. And the color you're wearing tonight, I just want to ask you about this. It seems to reflect the colors of a particular rival of this particular institution. Is that a coincidence?
I came in with a shirt this morning that was red, and I didn't even think anything about it until the kids started chanting, "Take off the shirt." So I thought if they wanted to holler about red, I'd really wear red this afternoon, because I had a son that I'm very proud of that graduated from Stanford and a really
fair
good
enough
friend that played there, John Arriaga. So I didn't mind doing a little bit for Stanford here tonight.
And by the way, that was called an intentional foul. So we just saw the two free throws. So it's a basket, two free throws, and the ball for UCLA. What a potential turning point.
See, I don't think you can call an intentional foul on a guy that gets fouled, going to the bucket, and makes the bucket.
I'm not a big fan of the intentional foul. I think it should be flagrant or excessive contact or nothing. That's a 7-point play right there.
7-point possession for UCLA, and they've got the lead after the three from Michael Roll.
Well, I'll tell you, this UCLA team, they got down to Stanford in a similar fashion. They stuck with it, and Cal has turned the ball over 10 times in this first half. 10.
So if they just call it a personal foul, it's a 3-point possession. By virtue of the intentional foul, that turned it into a 7-point possession.
Well, particularly there, it was just a crime that that UCLA wound up with the ball also.
Yeah, yes, that's true. Randall, and he is fouled. It's going to be a shooting foul, I think. They're going to call it on Holiday, and it will be two shots.
After that loose ball, Dragovich was in the corner. Robertson just grabs him from behind. Now, there's no question that is within the rule interpretation. The way the rule is written, that is an intentional foul. That's why I don't like this rule. I don't care his intent. It wasn't a foul that was flagrant or excessive. I think that's where the line should be.
How many times, though, have you seen that exact same thing happen going down the floor where the defensive man reaches from behind and hits the kid on the hip or whatever, and it's never called an intentional foul?
Exactly.
I think that was a terrible call right there.
And I think Mike Montgomery, as you can read his lips, was hollering after. That was a 7-point play.
Probably thought it was more intentional than, or a worse call rather than I thought it was, actually.
So we are tied at 30 late in the first half.
UCLA becoming a little bit more patient running their offense from side to side. They were just dribbling three or four possessions ago.
Wilkes did a really good job staying on his feet with the fake there. And now Cal switched very well, too. They're defending this possession awfully well.
Shot clock at 5. Shift creates a little space. Rebound Wilkes. Gutierrez equally comfortable at both guard spots, but he slipped and walked. More college action coming your way Monday night. It is Big Monday, presented by Bud Light, beginning at 7 Eastern here on ESPN. Villanova taking on Notre Dame at South Bend, and then at 9 Eastern, it'll be Baylor and Texas out of the Big 12. Jay, give us your Texas assessment right now. Where do they sit?
Well, Texas is having a hard time scoring. They need to get the ball inside more.
Dragovich left wide open, finally knocks one down, and UCLA takes the lead, and the officials are going to review that to see if it was a 2 or a 3.
Well, that was a result of Dragovich holding his position while both people went after the ball. And the pass was very instrumental because two guys picked up the ball was passed to the open man.
You can see the yellow line is the new three-point line in men's basketball that came in this year. And it looked like his toe was just on that line.
And the officials concur after seeing the replay. So it's a two-point basket and a two-point lead for the Bruins. Dragovich taking over for Keefe as the starter up front. Right about the time that conference play began, and he has been, as you can see, a consistent double-figure scorer for Ben Howland ever since.
You know, he really stretches the defense, and he causes your four-man or sometimes your five-man to have to defend out on the perimeter. Cal needs to take better care of the ball. They've turned the ball over 12 times. That's been the difference in this game.
You know, Darren Randall gave it up, and he got into the offense. I think that's better for them because he just had it on the dribble too much. And almost the same thing there as far as Robertson was concerned.
And once Randall gives the ball up, then he can go and be a screener and maybe cause some switches or some mismatches.
Get it back.
Get some better offense.
Get it back, and then he can create something from there.
Ship called for the foul, his first. UCLA over the limit, 1-1 for Robertson. Cal so heavily dependent on their three perimeter players, although we've seen Robertson go inside as well. But Robertson, Christopher, and Randall, so heavily dependent on them to do the bulk of the scoring.
And so many defenses are just loading up on those three guys. And when they played Southern Cal, you know, Tim Floyd would have his defenders face guard those three players and make the other two guys beat you.
Whether it's Wilkes, Boykin, or Camp, whoever's up front. Dragovich peeling it now, misses the three, and Gutierrez races way out of his area to corral the rebound. Gutierrez, one of these guys, as soon as he comes off the bench and into the game, you're aware of his presence. Just great energy off the Cal bench.
And toughness, too. I mean, he's physically tough and he's mentally tough.
Randall inside, scoops it up and in! Ben Howland says, hold it for one. The biggest crowd they've had at any game in this building this year, and the loudest crowd in all likelihood as well. They were ready for the Bruins here at Haas Pavilion.
Got to get going.
Collison gets inside, misses it. And the first half will come to a close with the Bears holding a two-point lead. Jerome Randall outscoring Darren Collison in the first half. And Cal and UCLA tied for second in the Pac-10. It's Cal by two at the break. Aaron Andrews is with Mike Montgomery.
Dan, thanks, Coach.
Absolutely. I've never seen that called an intentional foul.
Okay. Yeah, see, I think by rule it was the right call. I don't like the rule, but I think as the rule was written, I don't think Robertson was trying to make a play on the ball. I think he was trying to grab him from behind to stop him from making the layup. Now, it wasn't excessive, it wasn't flagrant, but I think it was intentional, and by rule, I think the referee had to call what they called.
Now, to Cal's credit, after that play, they went out and scored the last 4 points of the half, so they recovered after that. And enter the second half with a two-point lead. These are the two teams tied for second in the Pac-10 behind Washington. And they've also got not only identical conference records, identical overall records at 21-7. And there's a foul on Jordan Wilkes. Let's begin with Aaron Andrews.
Dan, I had a chance to speak with UCLA assistant coach Scott Duncan during halftime. He said defensively, he said he felt like his team finally put some pressure on Cal. That's how they were able to get back into it. Of course, that seven-point possession did help them as well, which they were very thankful for on UCLA side. Offensively, they need to be more patient. He said Coach Ben Howland wants to see his team make that extra pass. Guys, a little note from Cal's side of things. Coach Knight's favorite player, Harper Camp, he's been very sick during halftime. He's been excusing himself the past couple seconds over behind the bleachers here to get sick, so have to keep an eye on him as well.
Right, so may or may not see him back in the second half. Holiday follows up his miss and then misses again, but it'll still be UCLA ball.
You know, as poor of a call as I think that was, the difference in the first half, actually, Dan, is the fact that Cal turned the ball over 12 times and UCLA three. And Cal's defense completely fell asleep there. Nobody picked up the man away from the ball.
But Aaron, when she talked to the UCLA staff, they talked about patience. And for UCLA, that means running good offense, making hard cuts, moving the ball from side to side, and giving the defense a chance to make a mistake, not just holding the ball for the clock.
Christopher got started early before he picked up a couple of fouls. Holiday knocks the ball out of bounds for the Bruins. This UCLA team lost a lot from last year, as everybody knows. Russell Westbrook, Kevin Love, Lucas Chardonbaugh, Moutet from the Final Four team. They are 21-7. They have been ranked all season long, but they've only got one win the entire year over a ranked team, and that was a home win against Washington.
Chip with the layup. Beautiful feed. Bruins by two.
Boy, that was a tremendous pass because he was looking for pass all the way, and he threaded the needle right through the lane to the cutter. I actually thought he was going to hit the man in the middle, but he saw something I didn't see out there.
Now Randall, he has it blocked by Collison, saved by Boykin, but only temporarily. It'll be UCLA ball.
Well, there's the difficulty for Jerome Randall. He is so small. You see Collison now getting that great outlet pass, and Josh Shipp along the left-hand side. Now that he's healthy, he can really get out and run the lanes, and you can see his athleticism shining through.
Collison playing off the ball a little bit this trip. Put on the line as he knocks down a long shot. They're going to give him a three. With the naked eye, I thought he had the toe on the line, but it is ruled a three-pointer. But UCLA is up by five, and Mike Montgomery wants a timeout.
Timeout.
Very good start for the Bruins in the second half, actually at both ends of the floor.
7-0 run for UCLA to begin the second half, forcing the timeout. No, he got behind the line. It is a three, Bruins by five. Pavilion, Dan Shulman, Bob Knight, Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews, and the rest of our crew. The Game Day Gang is here. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. UCLA, a 7-0 run to start the second half, including a Collison three, and the Bruins are up by five. Leo Robertson penetrates and lays it in.
They got the ball into the middle of the lane, but that was a nice little back pick and rescreen. And on the rescreen, Jamal Boykin was wide open under the bucket. They just missed him.
And you know, so many times, Jay, I think that when a bucket is scored going to the basket, help side defense is not where it should be.
Chip driving. Good cut by Holiday. Can't finish. Wilkes may have gotten a piece of it.
Just tried a little finger roll there. I think Holiday needed to go up a lot stronger.
Randall gets around the hedge. Wilkes got it to go.
Really a bad move coming off the ball screen by the defensive man. He went after the ball, and Wilkes reacted very well immediately by going to the bucket.
UCLA Bruins, by far the winningest team in the Pac-10 in recent years. Three consecutive regular season titles, three consecutive trips to the Final Four. But this is a different team, a younger team. Although they do have experience in the likes of Collison and Aboya. In and out for Dragovic.
Little push from behind by Wilkes.
Let's go back to that last play at the other end, Coach, that you were talking about.
All right, they both go after the ball momentarily. Wilkes makes a really good move, and there's no recovery inside from the help side by the Bruins.
Yeah, Boya needed to come over from that weak side. He's just slow getting there.
And a foul on Boykin of the Bears. Mike Montgomery of the two coaches has been the more displeased with the officiating so far tonight. Wilkes out, Camp back in. And Boykin comes up with a steal. Cal looking to push. Randall hits Robertson in stride and one.
On the break, that's their little pass advance break option. And Robertson, instead of spotting up at the three-point line, which, frankly, a lot of three-point shooters do now, he got all the way to the rim, got the inside track, and was able to square up and still make that despite the contact. He is a strong, strong guard.
And you know, a boy, you kind of slipped out of a draw-the-charge position there also, and yet still drew the foul. If he'd have stayed right in that lane, he may have at least prevented the bucket and certainly had a chance to draw the charging foul.
So a 7-0 run for UCLA to begin the second half. Mike Montgomery calls a timeout. A 7-0 run for Cal since then. Great rebound at the offensive end by Collison. Lost it. Shipp with a tough layup.
Well, Josh Shipp on the broken play. I thought that was a bad shot by Alfred Aboya. But Darren Collison bailed him out by going after that rebound.
Chip has a real good arsenal of weapons to score. He's a very good scoring forward.
Robertson for three, one of the best in the country. 53% on the season from beyond the arc.
Well, these guys don't toe the line. They shoot it from well behind it, and Robertson, a very good pull-up jump shooter, even from deep.
Cal 5-for-9 from three tonight. It'll stay with UCLA. We'll go to a media timeout here early in the second half. No team in America shoots the three with as much accuracy as the California Golden Bears, and it's given them the lead. There is his presenter at his induction, and you made a statement, Coach, on game day this morning that things that Pete Newell and Henry Iba brought in 60 years ago are still being used today by tons of coaches who don't even realize where those things trace back to.
Absolutely, and you could put Claire B. into that group of also, Dan. Coaches are doing a lot of things we all did, I did, that those guys pioneered, and the innovations many times were theirs, and the rest of us just kind of took advantage of what people like that did.
And Jay, later on we came to know Pete Newell as the guy who ran the big man camp. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, he was a great teacher, and I knew Pete Newell, and when I was in high school, I lived right near him. He lived on a street called Grand Via Altamira in the Rolling Hills area where I went to high school, and he helped me with my college decision. He used to come to my high school games, and I just love Pete Newell. I mean, you were not going to find a nicer person. I mean, he was a great competitor, a great coach, but he always had time for someone who loved the game and who was willing to learn. Always had time for, whether it was a coach or a player, always had the time.
Passed away in November, and the court name for him here at Cal. There's great tradition here. This is the 100th season of Cal basketball. And such familiar names as Jason Kidd and Kevin Johnson, who's here tonight, by the way, are among those who played their basketball here in Berkeley. Robertson rips down the rebound. Randall lost it. Too many blue jerseys. And then UCLA cannot take advantage of the 4-on-2.
They really didn't react quickly to having the ball and getting it right inside.
And when Randall caught that ball, he should have caught it, faced the defense, and then gone. He caught it and dribbled. That allowed Collison to steal it.
And there's KJ, who's here tonight, current mayor of Sacramento, a great guard in his day. Christopher quiet offensively since he was the dominant guy in the first 6 or 7 minutes of this game. Camp, beautifully done.
Well, Camp did a great job on ball reversal of getting right into the middle of the lane and locking down his defender and creating that angle. That was well done by Carper Camp.
You know, and then using his left hand on top of it to keep it away from the defensive man.
And remember, bad knee, bad calf, and was sick at halftime and even early in the second half, but he's come back in and made a difference just as he did in the first half.
They're showing how tough he is because he's no fun to play against right now.
Made Gordon work hard. Collison reaches around from behind, pokes it away. Christopher's got it.
See, Randall is so much smaller, being guarded right now by Drew Holiday. Tough for him to see over. If Holiday gets his hands up, he could have deflected that pass.
Nice little fake by Boykin, but away long on the jumper. Got it back. Got it back again. Christopher. Camp, an offensive rebound.
Well, I'd love to have Camp on my team.
I think about 11,000 people here and Mike Montgomery share that sentiment. He has had a terrific night in limited minutes. Robertson open. And UCLA comes up with a loose ball.
Almost like the Bruins are waiting for those loose balls to come up into their hands. They need to go after the ball harder.
Cal's doing a pretty good job of keeping the ball out on the perimeter, although the help man from the screen right there just did not react at all. He didn't move into the path of the screener. When they set that ball screen, the guy defending the screener has got to make the ball move further to the outside or go in the opposite direction, and he did neither there.
Collison makes it a three-point game. Time now for tonight's Inside the Play, brought to you by Microsoft People Ready Enterprise Solutions.
You can see as the ball goes reversal here. It's going to go inside. That's a great job of sealing by Camp. On ball reversal, he just got into his man, created that angle, and sealed him on his hip. Just a great job by Harper Camp, who has worked as hard, if not harder, than any player on the floor tonight.
Big Monday, presented by Bud Light, is on ESPN. It begins at 7 Eastern as Villanova travels to South Bend. Man, do the Irish need a big win. They played well, but it came up just short at UConn today. And then the second game out of the Big 12, Baylor in Texas. Big Monday, presented by Bud Light, beginning at 7 right here on ESPN. 1 week from tonight, our final Saturday prime game will be in Morgantown as the Louisville Cardinals will pay a visit to West Virginia. 3-point lead for the Bears. 8 minutes into the second half here at Haas Pavilion. Gutierrez in off the cabbage.
Walk on time.
Christopher. Got it to Boykin. Boykin had to get out of there.
Good help defense by UCLA. Two times in a row keeping the ball on the perimeter.
Randall inside, and a block is the call on Keith. Timeout on the floor. Got a good one going between the Bruins and the Bears with a lot on the line near the top of the of the Pac-10 standings. Cal leads by 3. All right, Dari, thank you. And more Big East action coming your way, as we mentioned, Monday night. Villanova, Notre Dame here. Cal leading UCLA by 3. A part of Judgment Week here on ESPN, our Saturday primetime game presented by DirecTV. UCLA and Cal both 10-5. In Pac-10 standings. Earlier today, Washington won again, beat Arizona State, and Washington State is hot. They beat Arizona. Cal by 5.
Cal is really doing a nice job of executing on out of bounds underneath. That was another little simple screen for the screener play. Randall sets a screen, then comes off a screen. He was wide open to step into that shot.
And the 3 at the other end by Michael Roll. Michael Roll, a very underrated shooter as well. He's got stats that can rival just about anybody's. He's 53% on the season as well, same as Robertson.
Well, he got set up perfectly and didn't hesitate on that shot.
Christopher's first points since the 12:15 mark of the first half.
That shot was taken by a great athlete because he really wasn't set, but he got himself set in the air when he went up for the shot.
Boyer, good patience, draws the foul, and it goes.
A nice shot fake underneath when he made that move along the baseline. The defense really in a frenzy to try to cut him off. Just a good spin move along the baseline, and Wilkes should have cut that off by just taking that one step and getting a foot essentially out of bounds.
I'm glad that you have such an affinity for the shot fake. I think that's just a great thing. That's a part of your broadcasting repertoire.
Well, guys that couldn't jump had the shot fake. I couldn't go over anybody, so I had to get them in the air first.
3-point play for Aboya. He's on his way to a double-double. 9 points and 9 rebounds at this juncture. UCLA back within 2.
Now, Aboya just outworks people.
Holding on the cut off the screen, you're down inside. He's going to put Christopher on the... Christopher was fouled coming off the cut.
Well, let's take a look at the Pac-10. Washington on its way, barring an extremely unforeseen series of events, to an outright Pac-10 championship. Cal and UCLA battling for the second spot. Right now, Jay, what to you is the biggest story or surprise in the Pac-10 right now?
Well, I'm a little bit surprised by Washington. I knew they were going to be good. I just didn't know their defense was going to be this good. And, you know, their freshman Isaiah Thomas, I think, stepped forward to be the freshman of the year in the conference. And I think the biggest improvement by a player was Justin Dettman. You know, he was a point guard, and now he's a scoring guard and put himself in position to be considered for Pac-10 Player of the Year.
Coach, we saw Washington for a couple of games in November in Kansas City. What are your thoughts on the Huskers?
Well, remember, we talked about Dan in the second night that Washington played. We talked about how much better they were than they were the first night. They had improved. They were a little tighter with what they did on the offensive end, and better defensively than they were. We said then if they continued that kind of improvement, they were going to be a very good team.
Pretty play from Amoki to Randall to Wilkes for the bucket.
And it was a great cut by Jerome Randall to the basket. And when the defense helped up, he was able to dump it down to Wilkes.
There's another shot fake, and Collison draws the foul.
Again, a great use of the shot fake, and it drew the foul that time and would have resulted in a pretty good 15-foot shot. Was the threesome you talked about from here to there, Dan, something like Tinker to Evers to Chance?
Pretty good, not bad. Although, as you well know, being a baseball fan, most of their double plays went Evers to Tinker to Chance. But it sounds better the other way. You got a little affinity for the St. Louis Cardinals, right?
Very much so. I think a great deal of their manager.
4-point lead for Cal. Roll from the baseline, way long. Randall runs down the rebound, and he's fouled.
Well, that's the kind of play when it happens, and you're the defender. You're about 6 feet away from being able to get the ball, and you make a move toward it, and that's just unnecessary hustle that results in a foul.
And Ben Howland is not happy with this group. He's making four changes as Dragovich, Holiday, Shipp, and Anderson have all checked into the game at the same time. The only guy who is staying on the floor for UCLA is Alfred Aboya.
They cut down their quickness on offense just a little bit with this change in the lineup.
Randall working off the ball now. He gave it up to Gutierrez.
Got it back, missed the three. And Shipp rips it away from a couple of Bears. Aboya fouled by Amoki. That's a tough matchup for Amoki.
Well, he just worked so hard. Post to get that low block. He wouldn't let Amoki get around him. Just stayed low, and when a postman stays low and gets contact on a post defender, it's hard for that defender to break contact and get around.
Dragovich knocks down another three.
When Dragovich has shown, not just in this game, but in his career, that if he's involved in an out-of-bounds situation, you either got to get into him or switch to him so he can't catch it ready to shoot.
They lost so much offense, so much talent from a year ago. This year, players like Aboya and Dragovich have become so much more important at the offensive end. Great work by Amoki. Can't finish. And now the Bruins have a chance to take the lead again.
Somewhere they might have called that a foul on a charge.
Yeah, Aboya put his body on the line. It looked like he was there.
Shipped right into Wilkes, and it's out of bounds to Cal.
Yeah, that was one where you pull it back out. There was nothing there for Josh Shipp.
This is where Cal has to get up a little higher, get it spread, and see if they can develop going into the last few minutes like a 5 or 6 point lead by the time they get to 5 minutes left. Then they can win the game from the free throw line.
Got a small lineup in there right now. Theo Robertson is effectively the power forward. They've really got four perimeter players plus Camp. And there's a foul on Anderson.
No, Anderson turned right away. When he changed direction with the dribble, Anderson turned into him immediately.
Each team now with six fouls this half.
Now, Jerome Randall has been setting a screen and then coming off a screen in some of these out-of-bounds plays.
Christopher's going to come off of it. Now, Randall's going to be the second guy.
Double teamed out there. Randall on the perimeter found Robertson, but he couldn't get the shot off. Robertson in trouble. And a held ball.
Cal ball. Possession to California.
Robertson probably had a chance to come up with the shot at about 12 feet when he entered the lane, and he just tried to take it a bridge too far.
Collison now back in for Anderson for UCLA.
It's so difficult for UCLA on the offensive end to get some flow. They don't have the same post presence that they had last year when they had Kevin Love and Luke Richard and Bamute. There's nobody to throw the ball into.
Camp gets bumped out of there and turns it over. Aboya caused that turnover. Collison Collison switches hands, and UCLA takes the lead.
Now, Collison made a little hesitation move right at the free throw line to look and see if he had room, and then continued on to the bucket, which is so much better than making up your mind from out on the floor that you're going to drive to the bucket.
It's screened by Camp. Randall gets inside. Great hustle by Gutierrez to keep it alive, but the Bruins have it. Collison. Back-to-back buckets for Collison.
Well, Collison plays with such great pace. You know, instead of going full blast to the bucket, you know, he went to the basket and just hesitated and let the defense sort of fly by so he can complete the play. Well, that was great help on that ball screen by Alfred Aboy, and then recovering down to Camp.
A timeout on the floor, 7:02 to go here in Berkeley. Back-to-back baskets by Darren Collison, spearheading a 7-0 run for UCLA. And the Bruins in hostile territory here in Berkeley are now up by 3. For a quick moment, we'd like to send our best along to legendary coach John Wooden, who is recovering from pneumonia. The last word we heard earlier today, still in hospital, but expected to make a full recovery. So from all of us, we wish Coach Wooden the best. 3 in and out for Christopher, and it'll be Bruins ball.
UCLA is so methodical both on both ends of the floor. They're doing a better job in the second half defensively, especially of staying in front. I didn't think in the first half their defense was as good as it has been in the second.
Dragovich with another 3. What a difference he has made, and this is the largest lead of the game for UCLA.
You know, he's got a really strong delivery with the shot, but he gets his feet set very well. He does not go up off balance to take that shot, even though he didn't have a lot of room that time.
And his role has been growing and growing over the course of the season. Robertson gets free for a moment, misses the 3, rebound shift. Collison, count it!
What great body control by Darren Collison. Just slipped that charge, got the contact, and was able to finish that play. And he's shown the ability to use his right and his left hand. And here, just slipping it with the body control and using his right.
And, you know, he's not worried about the contact that's going to come. He had tremendous concentration on the board where he was going to put the ball up on the glass. And you've talked about how good he is and what he means to a team. And you may even underestimate just how good he is, I think.
Well, he's been a winner his whole career. And you know, I really thought that Ben Hallen was able to turn the UCLA program around when he recruited guys like Aaron Aflalo and Jordan Farmar. But I'm not sure he's had a winner quite like Darren Collison. Just an unbelievable winner.
13-0 run right now for the Bruins. There's a block on Dragovich. Darren Collison coming into the season was considered to be maybe the best point guard in America, certainly in the conversation. And I think, Jay, because UCLA has not had the kind of season they've had the last 3 years, maybe there's a perception that Collison hasn't had that good of a season. Is that fair?
No, not really. I think he's had to do more. I mean, last year, you know, he's third right now in three-point percentage at 44%. Well, that's down for him. Last year, he shot over 50% from 3, shot over 50% from the field, over 50% from 3, and over 90% from the line. I mean, that's incredible efficiency, and he doesn't turn the ball over a lot. You know, top of the Pac-10 in assists every year. I mean, he's been an extraordinary point guard for them.
Boyk in the miss, but the rebound of the Bears. Great recovery by UCLA. These shooters can't get enough of a look, but there's a foul going on the Bruins. I think it's Dragovich again.
Ooh, can we get a look at that one again?
Yeah, that was a flop. He'd have to get hit by 3 guys to go down that hard.
Harper Camp to the line for 1-1.
They just lost 2 points at the free throw line. They can't afford to lose points from the free throw line.
Well, this game is kind of typical of what people have seen in the Pac-10 all season long. Jay, you were at Stanford Thursday night, and the Cardinal had a big early lead. UCLA came back and won by 5. here Thursday night. Cal needed overtime to beat USC. There was an overtime game earlier today in the Pac-10. And I know you said on game day, you think 9 of the 10 teams in this conference could conceivably win the Pac-10 tournament.
I don't think there's any question. I mean, you wouldn't favor the 8th or the 9th team to do it, but it's certainly possible. I mean, a team like Stanford's lost so many one-point games. They've proven they can beat these teams.
Nice jump hook by Aboya.
Good feed by Dragovic. He got the ball inside, away from the defensive man.
Well, Boy has had a terrific game. He's played hard on both ends. He's been in on every play. I mean, he was terrific against Stanford. Made some free throws down the stretch and some winning plays down the stretch.
Camp off to Boykin. And Boykin misses the layup. What a beautiful bounce pass from Camp.
That was a big bucket along with those two missed free throws. They're getting at a point in the game now. With UCLA having a 9-point lead, they've got to take advantage of their scoring opportunities.
This is really the kind of defense you expect to see from a UCLA team. They have defended much better in the second half. That looked like a walk. Yeah.
Dragovic long on the three. Randall has it. Does not have the numbers. Going inside anyways. And gets it to go.
Well, that was a great athletic play right there because he really didn't have any opening to do anything with it. He's just so quick with his hands that he got the ball up without it being blocked.
And he is just ultra quick, and he's got great concentration. Even though he's small, he's able to finish plays with contact.
This is a big, big defensive possession for Cal right here. Huge.
Collison for three.
That's no good. Got it back. Yeah. That gives him a chance to run more time off. I don't think Cal can get in a situation where they can come right out and foul now.
No,
but they can't let them get an offensive rebound.
Well, they're going to wind up playing over 60 seconds of defense on this one possession.
Ooh.
They come up with a turnover. Christopher with the reverse.
That was a very costly turnover by Dragovic because instead of being up 9, they're up 5. And now it is so much easier for a Cal to get into a position where they can win this game than it was if UCLA could have scored on that possession.
Yeah, Dragovic just showing the ball. And see Randall taking it the other way. He's so quick. And especially in the open court, the nice hesitation move, stop and go, and finishing over Aboya. And you know, what a terrific pass and a great finish with the left hand. Again, coach using the basket to shield off a shot block.
You look at the atmosphere here at Haas Pavilion, a sellout here tonight. A great crowd early in the morning for game day. They open the doors at 6 a.m. locally, and why not? They're excited about their team that was 6-12 in the Pac-10 each of the last 2 years, and they are 10-5 right now and looking to move into sole possession. The winner of this game will have sole possession of second place in this league.
Well, I'll tell you, Stanford was able to beat Southern Cal today on senior day over at the farm. And how about the job at Oregon State that Oregon State has done this year? They've got a big guy named Roland Schaffnauer, who I've seen play, that I just love his game. I mean, he can step away, knock shots down, good passer, very skilled. And I think Craig Robinson's done a very nice job of that program.
Chip for three. Rebound by Holiday, and he's fouled. Drew Holiday coming up with a big offensive rebound.
Well, that may be the biggest rebound of the game right there because it gives him a chance to get that lead back to 7.
The freshman to the line when we come back to Berkeley. We are down to the last 3 minutes and 14 seconds. A terrific night in many respects for Darren Collison of UCLA. Patrick Christopher was the big scorer early in the game for Cal. And here's Drew Holiday at the line, the highly touted freshman who came in with so much publicity. A lot of people thought he was an automatic one-and-done kind of guy. Has not put up those kinds of numbers. Seems more likely he'll stick around as he knocks down a couple of big free throws for Ben Howland.
Really, really big free throws because that enabled them to maintain about a 4 offensive possession lead.
Under 3 minutes to go.
UCLA has done a much better job staying with Cal's shooters in the second half.
Aboya called for the foul. Virtually identical play that happened about 10 seconds ago on the other side of the court as The chin of Randall keeps running into the hip of Aboya.
Well, anytime he hedges out, you got to go right into it. Every time.
To force the contact and get the foul.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. Jay's absolutely right about that. And on the other hand, the defensive man has got to slide with him rather than slide into his path.
Remember, Cal is by no stretch out of this game. This is the number one three-point shooting team in America. And they've got some great free throw shooters as well, including the man at the line right now.
Well, Randall's their career leader in free throw percentage, and he's got a terrific all-around game.
If you were behind, if UCLA was behind and they came off that screen late in the game, maybe you try to go for the ball, but now you just stay away from it. You just don't let them get to the line where they can score with the clock stopped.
Yeah, you just angle out that screen, stretch it out instead of jumping out and allowing the ball handler to dribble right into contact and force that foul. Because those things go 90% of the time against the big guy who's defending.
Spoken like a true big guy.
Yeah, it's so unfair, isn't it?
Collison inside over Camp. Rebound Robertson. Cal recovers and picks up the loose ball. They got a chance to get it down to three or maybe two.
Randall's got to start coming back to the ball. If he's catching it, running away from the ball, he's putting himself in a position to turn the ball over. UCLA's been pretty alert to that.
Christopher, way long.
Oh, my. Too quick, too far. Oh, that was not, that may have been the worst possession Cal has had tonight.
Yeah, it's so tough when you're running full speed away from the basket to set yourself and take a good shot.
That's where shot fake and drive, and now you're playing 5-on-4.
And patience from the Bruins. Shot clock at 5. Collison forces it up and goes. What a shot!
Well, that thus far is the biggest bucket of the game.
No question. With the shot clock winding down and the ball in the hands of Darren Collison. Difficult move. He lost control of it. But yeah, you've seen him make shots like that so many times.
And, you know, from the Cal standpoint, they did about everything they could defensively. They didn't give up a foul. They didn't give up an open shot.
Senior All-American candidate now with 20 points tonight, Darren Collison. The NBA is on ABC tomorrow. It's the Pistons and the Celtics beginning at 1 o'clock Eastern time. The Lakers and the Suns at 3:30. Coverage begins at 12:30 Eastern with the GMC NBA countdown. And then tomorrow night, LeBron and the Cavs taking on the Atlanta Hawks at 8 o'clock Eastern here on ESPN. Great triple header of NBA action. Don't forget the college doubleheader with Villanova Notre Dame and Baylor Texas Monday night. Big Monday presented by Bud Light. What a second half. What a night overall for Darren Collison.
Well, he's done it so many times throughout his career. And they rely upon him to create offense. Now, that wasn't his role last year. And he's an excellent on-ball defender. I think all around, it's going to be hard for you to find a better point guard in college basketball.
And Cal needs to think about a quick score
quick
here.
Shot fake.
Robertson inside gets the layup. Did you talk about shot fakes as much with your players as you do sitting with us here at the table?
We worked on a shot fake every single night of practice. Every night we worked on it, sometimes against mock defense and sometimes against no defense. Just catch it, make your move up, get somebody up in the air, one dribble and take the shot. And that was just an absolute classical example. The guy's out of control, coming out on the man that's received the ball. He goes out of the play, and now it's 5-on-4 for Cal.
I can't tell you, Dan, how many times you've been to a Bob Knight practice where he's talking about not only shot fake, but deception as being a big part of the game of basketball.
I used to argue with Bill Parcells all the time about the goal line offense inside the 5 or 6 yard line. Deception. Fake it to this guy, fake it to that guy, pitch it out. I just think that the deception that you can put in to what you're doing in heated moments of play is so important because everybody's anxious to go, whether it's football or basketball, and deception is a real key to winning in close circumstances at the end of a game.
A quick foul by Camp, and that's going to put Aboya on the line with a 1-1. And Aboya is a 67% free throw shooter. SportsCenter is next here on ESPN. What Cal needs to do more than anything is make sure somebody other than Collison is shooting free throws here at the end of the game for UCLA.
I'll tell you, Aboya may not be a great free throw shooter, but against Stanford, the Cardinal put him on the line, and he knocked those free throws down. I mean, Aboya is a senior. And stepped to the line with great confidence over in Palo Alto and knocked down some really big free throws at the end of the game.
1-1 for the senior.
Now this is a measure of mental toughness. Now you may not be the best free throw shooter, but when you can step to the line with confidence and knock free throws down, especially in pressure situations when you're tired at the end of the game, I think that's a great measure of mental toughness.
That free throw put the game in at least a three possession position for Cal to win, and it's still there.
This is the second. Next time they go to the line, it'll be two.
Now, Cal doesn't need to take a hurried three.
Christopher kind of fading away, a little off balance. Camp misses but is fouled, and Harper Camp will be going to the line.
Well, just what UCLA didn't want to do, that's commit a foul so that Cal can score with no time going off the clock.
But, you know, we've talked about Camp the whole game. He wasn't standing watching the shooter or watching the flight of the ball. He was just getting to position where he could get it if it came off the board.
Fourth on Dragovic. Two free throws for Camp. Here comes Wilkes. Senior night for Jordan Wilkes.
Jordan Wilkes coming into the game now, so that the game will stop and Cal's got an opportunity to set up its defense.
I'd want to handle the ball a little bit right now if I were UCLA, I think, against Wilkes.
Collison gives it up to Schiff.
Needs to get rid of it.
Schiff handled that very well. You say get rid of it, you're so right, because it's used up time. Got a lot of time running off now.
What do? Do you foul or do you play out the possession?
Well, now they got to play it out. You don't want to foul now.
And you don't want to foul him.
I think you got to foul, Jay, because it's going to be down to 20 seconds, and that's all that's going to be left if they don't.
Collison inside. Another huge play.
And what a winner. It is so hard to stay in front of Darren Collison. He's not only got quickness, he's got great speed. And his body control, again, slipping the charge and the contact on the part of Jordan Wilkes.
You know, when Collison starts his drive, whoever is on either side of him in the direction that he's making the drive has got to forget about his man, and he's got to slide in a position where Collison's forced to throw the ball off to the side and then recover to the man, because if you just play him one-on-one like that, like you said, he is so quick with the basketball that a little faint left, he goes right. Faint right, he goes left, and help has to be there.
16 of his 22 here in the second half. Big play after big play by Darren Collison. Going back to the first half, this was the most significant play in the first half. Dragovic on the drive, the intentional foul on Robertson. Dragovic makes the basket, makes the two free throws. UCLA gets the ball back. Roll hits the three. And as Mike Montgomery said to the officials walking off the court at the end of the half, that was a seven-point play. That's the big play of the first half. Collison has had the big plays here in the second half.
See, that was for sure a three-point play. And if it had been a three-point play, we're now looking at 67-65.
Right. That's right. Yeah. And that's why I don't like that rule. I don't think intent should be a part of any determination by an official.
Well, it's hard to determine intent. You don't know what the intent is, you know. And again, you and I differ a little bit on it, because I felt that when he got the guy's arm, from what I've seen and what officials have told me in the past, yeah, he was going for the ball.
Well, now Cal will almost be forced to do what they do better than any team in the country, and that's
right,
shoot threes.
Schiff really helped out tremendously well right there. Schiff took that cross-court pass away. very, very good defensive play by Shipp.
And a great defensive play also by Drew Holiday. That's an in-vogue move, is essentially jump out of bounds and throw to the opposite corner. He cut that angle off, Holiday did, by going all the way down to the baseline.
There it is. Just what you were talking about.
Randall hits a three to make it a three-point game.
Randall gets himself open by setting a screen first, then he gets another screen, a screen for the screener action. That's been open all game long for Cal.
You know, UCLA just let up a little bit right there. Instead of forcing him to throw it out, he was able to throw it into a position where there was a shot, and he made a cut much quicker than the defensive man reacted to the situation. Here it goes, right here. He just got over too far. He went away from him, and if anybody's going to shoot a three, it's going to be Randall. You got to be right on top of him.
Yeah, that was actually a different play than they ran earlier. He just drifted to the corner off that little exchange.
So UCLA with the ball and a three-point lead, 16 seconds to go. The winner takes over sole possession of second place in the Pac-10. Keep in mind, UCLA finishes at home of the Oregon schools. Cal finishes on the road, Jay, at the Arizona schools. So the Bears have a tough road ahead.
They do. And Arizona State has played well, even though they lost today in overtime to Washington State. And I'll tell you, Washington State has a kid named Taylor Rochester, a left-handed kid, at 33 points against UCLA and another great game today. Hit like a 35-footer to win the ball game. But that is a tough way to finish for them.
Now, getting the ball inbounds here, let's talk about that for just a minute. UCLA has got to set up so they can cut to the baseline, not just set up along the baseline where they have to cut away from it. And they need their best free throw shooters up in position where when they do get the ball inbounds, there's a pretty good chance of them making a free throw. They got to get, I don't like them that tight to the baseline. I'd want them up higher, so they've got a lot of cutting room. Game's over with.
Aboya. And nearly stolen. Robertson inches away from saving that ball. Aboya was looking to get rid of it or run more time off the clock and almost turned it over.
Now Cal's got a foul right away when this ball comes in if they can't get a steal off the inbound.
Almost got it again. And now forced to foul Shipp, who's an 80% free throw shooter.
Dan, too much time went off the clock. There was at least a second and a half. That was well over 7 seconds.
Six-tenths of a second. Well, six-tenths of a second.
They just
I was watching the clock.
Well, they went from 6.7 up to 7.8 just like that. And now the officials are going to take a look at a
monitor.
That's
a little bit too much.
Yeah. Well, that's twice where UCLA almost gave the ball over to Cal in the last 5 seconds.
Well, Obayu didn't need to give up the ball when he did. He could have held it just a moment longer. Somebody makes a good move. Get the ball in Collison's hands, and I'm sure that's what Collison was trying to do. That was a very chancy pass. Now, see, that has to be an intentional foul right there. Absolutely. He has no chance of getting the ball. That's more of an intentional foul than the one that was called in the first half.
And it's almost like that's not called intentional because it's strategic more than anything.
Right.
And it's at the end of a game. But I agree. And that's why I think intent needs, you know, it's the rule that's the problem, not the way it's called. Well, it, maybe in this particular instance, but in the earlier one that was the 7-point play, I don't think the officials really have any choice given the way that the rules are written.
If you ran both of these plays back-to-back, what just happened here and what happened in the first half at the other end, you would find that this guy that made the foul had less chance of getting the ball than the guy that made the foul in the first half.
Shipp misses the first. 80% on the season.
I spoke a little bit too quickly on that long pass when I said this game is over with. A big free throw there, obviously.
Makes it a two-possession game.
It's going to be a quick three here. You can't foul.
Randall off balance. Doesn't go. Dragovic has it, and UCLA wins. They sweep a couple of regular season games from Cal as Ben Howland's team gets out of here with a four-point win and sole possession of second place in the Pac-10.
I just think that as we look at the game as it has been completed, no play. There are a lot of good plays made by both teams. No play more important than the 7-point play in the